Good afternoon, and I'm very pleased to be here. It's my pleasure to share with you this course, and I thank you all for allowing me this opportunity. And our talk today is going to be on drug handling in food addicts. We're going to review the principles of pharmacokinetics, and we'll discuss the effect of impaired kidney functions on these pharmacokinetics, and also in relation to extracorporeal therapies. And then we're going to discuss drug dosing, and we'll have special considerations. Okay, first to start with the definition, pharmacokinetics defines the process of drug absorption, distribution, binding, and elimination. And pharmacodynamics represents the interaction of drugs with its target site or receptor, and the pharmacological response that results afterwards. So when the patient takes a drug orally, it's going to be absorbed, and then it will undergo first pass to the liver, and then it's going to be distributed to the tissues and reaches the systemic circulation, where protein binding is going to take place. Mind you that it's only the free portion of the drug that will exert its effect at the tissue receptor, and it's only this part which is going to be cleared by dialysis. Then after that, the drug is going to go back to the liver for metabolism and elimination, and also to the kidney for clearance. So these are the steps of drug pharmacokinetics. You have absorption and you have distribution. And the volume of distribution will depend on the drug dose in relation to the blood concentration. If you have a big or a large volume of distribution, this means that little amount of the blood of the drug will be present in the blood. So in this case, little drug will be dialyzable, and probably this drug is going to be lipid soluble. This is if you have a big volume of distribution and the reverse is true. Then we have the protein binding, and then metabolism and renal handling. So these are the steps. Now let's see what happens to each of these steps when impaired function of the kidney occurs. First, with the absorption, there is going to be a decrease in the drug absorption because those patients have nausea and vomiting, they have gastroparesis, and because of the alkalinizing effect of the salivary urea, which changes to ammonia, so this will impair the absorption of drugs that need an acidic medium. And the same thing occurs due to the use of proton pump inhibitors and H2 receptor blockers that we usually give our patients. And also, the use of phosphate binders will form insoluble complexes with many of those drugs and will impair their absorption. And also, you have gut edema. So this is what happens in absorption. What about distribution? Your patient will fall in one of two categories. Either there's going to be an increase in the volume of distribution due to the presence of edema or ascites, or there is going to be a decrease due to the presence of acid wasting and volume depletion. So again, this is going to be aberrant. What about the protein binding? There is going to be a reduction in the protein binding because we have reduced albumin because of malnutrition, infection, etc. And because we have competitive inhibition with endogenous organic acids which accumulate in urea, and because we have changes in albumin structure and orientation, again reduced by urea, so protein binding will be reduced. Metabolism is going to be slow, also reduction and hydrolysis reactions. And finally, the renal handling, and sorry for the errors, they are more directed. There is going to be a reduction in the drug clearance and increase in the plasma half-life. The result will be accumulation of active metabolites of the drugs. So this is what happens with renal impairment in case of regarding the pharmacodynamics. pharmacokinetics. And for the pharmacodynamics, you get a decrease in the receptor number, and you get a decrease in the receptor binding, and you have altered signal transduction. So, by the time the patient reaches end-stage renal disease, he has not only alterations in both pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics, but he also is receiving multiple drugs with increased risk of drug-drug interactions. And also, these patients will undergo dialysis with clearance of drugs during dialysis. And those drugs which are removed by dialysis, we have to give a supplementary dose at the end of dialysis, which is equivalent, which is equal to the amount of the drug that was removed during the procedure. So, speaking of dialysis, we know that it removes drugs either intermittently when you use intermittent dialysis or continuously when we are using continuous dialysis. And the total clearance of the drug will depend on the residual kidney functions, because many of those patients still have a residual kidney functions, and will depend on the dialysis clearance, and will also depend on the non-renal clearance, like if it's cleared by the liver, for instance. So this is the total clearance of the drug will be the combination of the residual kidney function, non-renal function, and the dialysis. And what we are going to concentrate on today is going to be the dialysis. And the clearance with dialysis will depend on three major factors. First of all, the drug properties, something related to the drug itself, like the molecular weight, the hydrophilicity, if it is water soluble or not, and protein binding and the volume distribution, like we mentioned. And we also have the dialysis procedure itself, the dialysis properties, like the flow rates, the volume, and the duration. And we also have membrane properties, like the pore size and the surface area. So starting first with the drug properties, we know that in hemodialysis, solute diffusion occurs by diffusion through a semi-permeable membrane. And the smaller the molecular weight, the more easily the drug is going to diffuse across the semi-permeable membrane. Okay? What about other properties like the protein binding and hydrophilicity? Of course, only the free portion of the drugs that we mentioned that is there that can pass across the semi-permeable membrane, whereas the protein bound portions will not be able to pass. So therefore, if you have drugs that have a low protein binding, they are like the vancomycin, for instance, it easily diffuses across the semi-permeable membrane, whereas if you have other drugs like vancomycin and amphotericin, they have a big molecular weight and they do not diffuse across the membranes. So, speaking of molecular weight, drugs with 500 daltons have some impairment in their diffusion across the membranes when speaking about the conventional membranes, whereas if we reach 1,500 daltons, they are not usually passed across the semipermeable membranes when we are speaking about the normal membranes. Now we also have the dialysis procedure properties, like when you increase the flow rate of the blood, this is going to deliver more drug to the semipermeable membrane, so there's going to be more elimination of the drug. Also, if you increase the dialysate flow rate, this is going to increase the gradient and will increase the removal of the drug. Okay, so now we are left with, if we want to try to find out the extraction of the drug, then we have to look at this formula. We measure the concentration of the drug going in and out, and we divide it by the concentration of the drug in. And if 100% is removed, then the extraction is going to be equal to 1. And if extraction is equal to 1, then clearance of dialysis will equal the blood flow rate. There is another equation that we can find out the clearance by intermittent hemodialysis, which equals the clearance of urine multiplied by 60 and divided by the molecular weight of the drug. You're not going to be doing calculations. These are all present nomograms. Just telling you how these things are calculated. Okay? So, this finishes with the intermittent hemodialysis, and now speaking of the continuous dialysis, of course, you know that we have continuous arteriovenous and vein venous hemodialysis, and we have continuous vein venous hemodiafiltrations, and we also have continuous arteriovenous hemofiltration, venovenous hemofiltration, and slow continuous ultrafiltration. These are generally reserved for critically ill patients, and therefore any error in dose adjustment will result in deleterious outcome. And unfortunately, many guidelines are extrapolated from experiences with chronic intermittent hemodialysis or from theoretical considerations related to the pharmacokinetics of the drugs. The impact of volume distribution in a continuous therapy is going to be very small because drugs are rapidly equilibrated across the different body compartments. So when you're speaking about continuous therapies, we are speaking about acute kidney injury in an ICU setting. And in order to find out the clearance of the drug, we divide the dialysis concentration, dialysis by the plasma concentration, and we multiply by the dialysis flow rate. So the dialysis concentration and flow rates here are very important to determine the clearance by dialysis. What about the hemofiltration? In hemofiltration, pressure will drive the fluids across the hemofilter, and with it, there's going to be the drug will follow. So this we call solvent drag. So the drugs are going to be dragged along with the water in response to the high pressure. And the one thing that really determines the possibility of a drug to cross the hemofilter is what we call the sieving coefficient. The sieving coefficient, which is the concentration in the ultrafiltrate divided by the concentration in the plasma. And when the sieving coefficient approaches 1, this means that the drug can easily pass. Like if you look here at the casein, for instance, it's 0.9 and ampicillin 0.8. This means that the drug can easily pass through the hemofilter. Whereas if you compare this to ceftriaxone and cyclosporin, you find that the sieving coefficient is low. You know that when we do continuous therapies, we give substitution fluids either post-dilutional or pre-dilutional. So if we give it post-dilutional, then the saturation here is going to be 100%, and we do the same equation that we mentioned. Whereas if we give it pre-dilutional, this is going to be saturation reduced, will be reduced to 80%. And we have to incorporate in the equation not only the blood flow, but also the substitution flow rate. Again, I don't want you to panic on the equations. You're not going to be doing these equations by yourselves. So, what are our goals of therapy now? Our goal of therapy is to maintain the drug efficacy, whereas at the same time, avoid the accumulation and toxicity of the drug. So if this is the efficacy and this is the toxicity, you can have a wide therapeutic window or you can have a small therapeutic window. Now there's some nomenclatures that we have to understand, like bioavailability determines the amount of drug reaching the systemic circulation and therefore the amount and the site of action. Whereas the volume distribution determines the size of the loading dose. So when we are speaking about the loading dose, we have to consider the volume distribution. The clearance determines the maintenance dose. So when we speak about the maintenance dose, we have to consider the clearance of the drug. And the half-life determines the amount of time needed to reach a steady serum concentration or eliminate the drug. So if you want to prescribe a drug for a renal patient, there are steps that you have to take. First of all, you have to ascertain the level of renal function in terms of creatinine clearance, and then you have to establish the integrity of liver metabolism, because this is also one route of elimination. And you have to establish the loading dose, and then you have to establish the maintenance dose and consider the clearance. And you have to check for drug-drug interactions, and you have to decide on the blood level monitoring, because some of the drugs with a low, with a small therapeutic window, you will have a narrow therapeutic window, you will need to monitor the level of the drug in the blood. And finally, you have to make for the amount of drug that is going to be removed by dialysis by giving supplementary doses after the dialysis, or in the continuous therapy by augmenting the dose of the drug that is given to the patient. Now, you can, if the patient is not yet reaching the stage of hemodialysis or end-stage renal disease, in a CKD patient, you will have to estimate the GFR before prescribing the drug medications, and you can use formulas for that. There are many formulas. You have the CG formula and the MDRD formula. And if the clearance is low, it's better to use the MDRD formula. There are other formulas like the CKD EPI formula. And you have also formulas that incorporate the cystatine C. But mind you, if you're going to use a formula, then you have to have a steady state kidney functions and a constant serum creatinine. You cannot apply the formula when serum creatinine is continuously changing, like in the case of acute kidney injury. So, first to decide on the loading dose. The loading dose, we do not change the loading dose in the presence of renal impairment. It has nothing to do with the clearance, like we mentioned. The loading dose is required if you have a drug that has a long half-life, and if there is a need to rapidly achieve a desired steady-state concentration, and if the volume distribution is significantly increased. The loading dose of the patient can be obtained by multiplying the usual loading dose by the volume distribution of the patient divided by the normal volume distribution. Okay? Now we come to the maintenance dose, and this is where the clearance is very important, because if there is a change in the clearance, this will require a change in the maintenance dose. If the clearance is reduced to half, then you will have to reduce the maintenance dose by half, for instance. But there are specific strategies that you have to follow in order to obtain the maintenance dose. If you are giving the drug by infusions, you can slow or modify the rate of infusion. But if you are giving intermittent dosing, then you can either vary the dose, reduce the dose, or vary the frequency, you will increase the duration, or you can do a combination of both together. So, say if you want to do changing, if you want to change the dosing interval, so in order to obtain the interval, the new interval, suppose you have a patient with a clearance. So if you want to know the dosing interval, you divide the normal creatinine clearance by the patient's creatinine clearance, and you divide and you multiply by the normal interval. And if you want to change the dose, you will have to use the patient's clearance divided by the normal clearance, and you multiply by the normal dose. And I'm going to give you examples so as not to get mixed up. So here, if you want to change the dosing interval, supposing that you have a patient with a clearance of 20, and the drug is normally given every 8 hours, and now you want to change the dosing interval. So you're going to divide the clearance, which is supposed to be 100%, by the clearance of the patient, which is 20, and you multiply by 8, which is the normal dosing intervals in a normal individual, and this will give you a result of 40 hours. This means that you are going to use the same dose every 40 hours instead of every 8 hours. This is if you want to fix the dose. You can also have the option of changing the dose but keeping the intervals. And in this case, in the same case, if the patient, same patient has a 20 clearance, then you divide the 20 by 100, which is the normal clearance, and you multiply by the dose of the drug, which is taken by a normal person, say it's 100 milligrams, then you will get the result of 200 milligrams. This means that this patient can receive 200 milligrams every 8 hours, so you change the dose, but you kept the duration. You also can apply the two together. Like this example, for instance, here the drug dose, say, is 2,400 milligrams, and it's given as 400 milligrams every 6 hours. So if the patient has renal impairment and needs to receive 1,200 milligrams only, this can be given as 300 milligrams every 6 hours. So here you reduce the dose, but you maintain the duration. Or you can give it at 600 milligrams every 12 hours. This will give you the same result. So here, you fix the dose and you increase the duration. Or you can combine both together, like giving 400 milligrams every 8 hours. So here, you reduce the dose and you increase the duration. And again, you get the same result at the end. So which one to choose and what to do? It is a reasonable approach to start by increasing the duration until you reach 24 hours, then you start to reduce the drug dose. Okay? Now, keeping the dose will allow for a steady state concentration, but will have an increased risk of toxicity, whereas increasing the duration will have a reduced risk of toxicity, but you can get subtherapeutic levels of the drug. So when you want to decide on what dose to use, it's going to be completely individualized. It depends on whether your patient is in the ICU and you are in a hurry, or this is a cold case. So you have the option of starting low and going slow, or you go fast and you start high. Okay? Now, if the patient is in hemodialysis, you want to calculate the amount of the drug which is required to boost the present level to the desired level. So you can subtract the target level from the observed level from the target level, and you multiply by the volume distribution and the weight of the patient. Forget about the equations. You will have at the end guidelines for use in those patients, and here it shows an example of antibiotics, for instance. It tells you what to do when you have a clearance of 20 to 50 or 10 to 20 or less than 10, and what to do when the patient is on hemodialysis or when the patient is on peritoneal dialysis. In peritoneal dialysis, there is little drug removal when you're using this modality of therapy. So you can refer to those tables and you can know exactly what dose of the drug to use and what supplementary dose needs to be given after dialysis. I just want to tell you about special concentrations of the commonly used drugs, the drugs that we commonly use. So remember that thiazide diuretics is effective when the GFR is ineffective, when the GFR is below 20 to 40 milliliters per minute, or with a creatinine of more than 2.5 milligrams per deciliter. So when the patient has this level of kidney functions, thiazide diuretics will be of no use. Calcium channel blockers and alpha blockers need no dose modifications when the patient is on dialysis, whereas beta blockers, the dose should be 6.25 to 12.5 BID, and metoprolol and propranolol need additional doses post-hemodialysis. ACE inhibitors in general, there is going to be an almost 50% dose reduction. There is going to be difference in different individual drugs like captopril, enalapril, fosinopril, and clinopril. We need additional doses post-hemodialysis, whereas fosinopril and spiropril need no dose reduction. ARBs are not removed with hemodialysis, so they're better in these kind of patients to use. and they're less likely to produce hyperkalemia. Methyl-DOPA will have to increase to give an additional 250 milligrams post-hemodialysis. Digoxin, loading dose is not changed, and no reduction, but you have to do reduction in the maintenance dose and should be given post-hemodialysis. Statins, you will have to reduce the dose when you are dealing with kidney patients. Like, for instance, the atorvastatin, you should not exceed 20 milligrams, and rosuvastatin, you should exceed 10 milligrams, etc. So, giving these drugs in kidney patients depends more on the kidney function rather than on the level of lipids or cholesterol. Opioids, you have a problem with accumulation of toxic metabolites, therefore you have to reduce the dose. Non-steroidal and anti-inflammatory drugs increase the bleeding tendency. They are not recommended. And also they may reduce the GFR in those patients who still have residual kidney function and you want to keep it. Acetaminophen, there is no adjustment in the dose, and JNCO increases the bleeding risk if the patient is taking aspirin or warfarin. And in conclusion, impaired kidney function alters the drug pharmacokinetics, and clearance by hemodialysis will depend on factors of drug dialyzability, which are related to the drug itself, the dialysis procedure, and the membrane properties. Dose modification is crucial to produce the desired effect while avoiding toxicity. Extracorporeal drug clearance can be calculated based on the dialysate flow rate and protein binding, but for that you don't calculate yourself. You consult available literature on drug removal. Administration of a loading dose depends only on the target plasma level and the volume distribution. It does not require adaptation for extracorporeal removal, whereas adaptation for the maintenance dose needs to be reduced according to the renal function. For drugs with appreciable dialytic clearance, a supplementary dose is given post-intermittent hemodialysis, and you do augmentation of the maintenance dose in continuous renal replacement therapies. Supplementary doses derived from studies of low flux membrane should be empirically increased by 50% with high flux membranes. Measurement of serum concentration should be done, especially with drugs with a narrow therapeutic window. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor May, for this excellent presentation. And I think we have time for questions. Yes.